hath not heard, nor has it entered the heart of man, the things that God hath prepared for us that love him. He has so much more. So much more. Thank you, Women's Chorus, for ministering to us this morning through song. Some choirs in other churches sing, but our choirs minister in music. Each song seemed to be liturgically connected, pushing the next song to the next song and connecting it. What a joy, what a privilege. I greet you this morning with a Jesus joy. Amen. Thank God for all of you that have come to worship with us on this blessed Sunday morning, the last Sunday of the month of May. Thank God for all of those who are worshiping with us through our live streaming. May God bless you as well throughout this worship experience. Metaphorically, I was arrested last week. Metaphorically. Not because I broke the law, but because I was blessed by the Lord. And the actions that I did them on purpose to get arrested. I opened this book to the book of Hebrews, and I was detained and did not want to have my bail to go my bond. I was arrested by the word of God. I pray this day and this week that you'll get arrested, metaphorically, for the word of God. There's something powerful happens every time and any time you open up the word of God. If you just open it up and read it, much less study and meditate, you just read it. We didn't take this to the board, but it's already been approved. We're not having Sunday school anymore. When I got arrested, they gave me a summons to move to the hour of power. At 9:45 on Sunday, 12 noon on Wednesday, 7 p.m. on Wednesday night, they've been elevated and upgraded to code red, hour of power. I challenge you, I encourage you to bring your happy self to open up the word of God so that we can be the people and the church that God is calling us to be. I'll say more about that along the way before we end. But this morning, meet me at the place of my arrest, Hebrews chapter 2. I didn't want to add the word metaphorically, but I didn't want some of you to get alarmed. Pastor done got arrested. What is he doing? In the word of God. Hebrews chapter 2, we'll read from verse 9 through 18. I really like the way this section starts. But we see Jesus. We really could put a dollar in a meter and have church right there, but let me go on to give you the better context. Who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with honor and glory, that he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. For it became him for whom are all things and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For both he that sanctified and they who are sanctified are all of one, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the church will I sing praise unto thee. And again I will put my trust in him. And again, behold, I am the children which God hath given me. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had power of death, that is, the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Wherefore in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of all the people. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to succor them that are tempted. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his holy and precious word. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy. We pray now, God, for preaching and teaching power from on high, that your name might be lifted. For you said in your word, if I be lifted up, will draw all men unto me. It's in the mighty, precious name of Jesus that I pray, and all of God's disciples said, amen, and bless the Lord. Does anybody feel blessed this morning to just be in the house of God one more time? He didn't have to let us live, but he decided to allow our golden moments to roll on just a little while longer. Consider with me, if you will, from the subject, what a mighty God we serve. You heard those words before, but I pray this morning that this section of Hebrews chapter 2 will make it even more emphatically clear what a mighty God we serve. When I need a friend, I run to the rock. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard. What a mighty God we serve. We mentioned on last Sunday that this book of Hebrews, the dominant theme is the superiority of Jesus Christ. Amen. One worthy, the Bible scholar says, he can summarize it. Once we realize and begin to focus and meditate on the superiority of Jesus Christ, it will force us to mature. We'll move beyond just the milk and move on to the meat of the word. Amen. You'll find some key words there. One word is the word better. You'll find that word at least 13 times in the book of Hebrews. He's not just a little bit better. He's not just much better. He's infinitely better than the priest. He's better than the old covenant. He's better than the old priesthood. He's a better sacrifice. It's just better all the way around. And then the second word we come upon is the word eternal. He's not just better for a season. He's not just better for the balance of the year. He's better forever. And then at least 14 times you'll find the word perfect. So we have a better life in him. We can have a perfect position in Christ, and it is eternal. So if it's perfect, it's eternal, and it's better, then we ought to be living better for the Lord. Amen? In the first section of Hebrews chapter 2, it talks about the word, the warnings of Jesus. They were being persecuted, amen, and they were being tempted to go back to the Jewish religious system that focused on the law and not on the Lord. But not only were they being tempted to go back to the Jewish religious system, they were drifting away from the Word of God and had begun to disobey the Word of God. So he writes to them to give them a warning to avoid the danger of slipping. And we tried to frame it for you so you could take it home and put it in your heart and begin to apply. We said we don't want to slip in our prayer life. We want to get back on our knees and cry out to God, because you do know the effectual fervent prayers of the righteous availeth much. Proverbs 15:29 says, God is far from the wicked, but he heareth the prayers of the righteous. You don't have to be a pastor. You don't have to be a minister, a deacon, or a trustee, or an elder. You that know the Lord can cry out to God for yourself, and he will hear. We talked about the danger of letting our prayer life slip, but we also talked about the danger of letting our study time of the Word of God slip. Some of us used to be very persistent and consistent in our study of the Word of God. Every day with Jesus was better than the day before, because you never let one day go by without at least reading a portion of God's Word. But you got so busy with your laptops and Palm Pilot and upgrade and down. Somebody said, God, once I retire, it's going to be you and me. We don't have time, and you are so busy now, we wonder how you had time to go to work. But we encourage you, study to show yourself approved. You can't blame the pastors and the ministers and deacons for all of your shortcomings. You that know the Word of God can read for yourself. God will give you insight and illumination as well as anybody else, but the Bible is a marvelous book, but it doesn't read itself. In your expensive cars that you now bless to drive, you can get downloaded apps and use technology as you're driving. It would help some of us, as you drive, not to be road rage, if you hear the word of God while you're driving, while you're stuck in traffic, you're going nowhere fast, you might as well get some word on the way home and make it a profitable ride. Amen? So we don't want to slip in our prayer life. We don't want to slip in our studying. That's why we're going to get back, and we'll see some of you this week in the hour of power, though I haven't seen you since last month. And then we don't want to slip in our worship. Our strategic plan told us very clearly and numerically that many of the Fort Foote family, other churches, members come twice per month as if they're doing God a favor by coming twice per month. But this Sunday, we open 5 Sundays. Most months at least open 4 Sundays. So, and see, when we start to mature, we won't allow small, little trifling matters, insignificant matters, to keep us from getting to worship. That you had a flat tire in the car. You got another one on the other side of the garage. Your friend, neighbor lives in your community. So when I'm serious about getting in God's presence, because Psalm 16:11 says, in his presence is fullness of joy, and his right hand are pleasures forevermore. When I really want to get with God, I won't allow anything and anybody to keep me from worshiping. They were tempted to stop worshiping God as they should. It's kind of like that old car. It's trying to warn you when it starts missing that. I need a tune-up. It's going to start missing before it stops. What a mighty God we serve. I gave you all that to get us to chapter 2. Chapter 2, 1 through 8 talks about the warnings. Hebrews is a book of warnings. It's a book of exhortation, which means to encourage, to lift up, to make better, but it's also a book of examination. As you and I take a moment to look at our own lives, we should be on our knees in repentance, on our way to becoming better. Amen? Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. I really like the way this section starts. Paul, we believe, was a writer. Most scholars agree that. In spite of the difficult times that they were going through, if you bring it up to date, what the scholars call the hermeneutical transfer, look at the ancient text, make it relevant and applicable to our lives today, that's the hermeneutical transfer, but we see Jesus. Many folk in Dallas and Houston, living in nice gated communities, had good income, had nice houses, cars, and careers, and life was going along fine. All of a sudden, boom! One meteorologist said rain came down within 24 hours that normally comes down in 24 days, weeks. And all of a sudden, without much notice, Dallas is flooded. Houston, ISIS is going crazy and recruiting people from blessed places in America to come and fight against something that they really don't understand. Come and join in terrorizing people. If ever we needed the Lord before. But we see Jesus in the midst of whatever you're dealing with this morning, in the midst of my little life challenges, and there are a few. Do I have a witness? But we see Jesus. That puts all of our lives, all of our situations in proper perspective. Amen. The problem is much of the world is not looking at the world through the eyes of Jesus, and they don't know him. They're not focusing on him. So you and I that know the Lord must be about our Father's business and share that we see Jesus. But there's a divine conjunction of contrast against, in spite of or because of all that has gone on before, we really need to see Jesus more than ever before. As you and I try to work through our life situations and our problems, issues, and concerns, we need to see Jesus. Dr. Gene Rice, the 50-year Old Testament scholar at Howard University, with his quiet, scholarly self, when we would come to him pouring out our hearts and concerns, he would quietly say, "What is God saying? What do you mean, what is God saying?" He said, "Can you see Jesus anywhere in the midst of you?" "Not right now." He said, "Wait, keep praying, keep looking, young man." He makes all of the difference. when you're dealing with those difficult children, and I understand I'm not for child abuse, but I understand better after this week. There's a little wonderful two-year-old who has more energy than he knows what to do with. So he finds toys that make their way to the toilet. He finds end tables and tack to be a distraction, so he tries to kick them and remove them. He cries whenever he wants to and does whatever he wants to do, and he wants what he wants right now. I needed to see Jesus, lest I would get arrested for child abuse. Climbing up on top of the coffee table going, Lord, have mercy, Jesus. You give them popcorn, they want potato chips. You give them potato chips, they want popcorn. He don't know what he wants. He just wants. And as I looked at a child, I said, I wonder, is this how God sees us? As little children, out of control, not disciplined. And so as I began to look at this little two-year-old through the eyes of Jesus, I went in and picked him up in my arm. He started laughing. I said, laughing? I wanted to. But we see Jesus. Because Jesus didn't slap you and me when we were off the hook, off the chain, said the young folk. Let me keep moving, lest I hold you too long. What a mighty God, we said. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. This train has a few stops this morning, and we'll be on at Grand Union Station. The first verses 9 and 10 talks about the saving ministry. Verses chapter 2, verse 1 through 8, talks about the warnings of Jesus, but now 9 through 18 talks about the work of Jesus. Are you tracking with me as I try to preach and teach a little bit this morning? The work of Jesus, we see the critical part, the initial part, the essence of his work was that his saving ministry. But we see Jesus. 2 Peter says that we were in darkness, but we've been called out of darkness, and now we walk in the marvelous light. Has anybody here ever been in darkness? If you're in darkness, you can't see. But when you get called out of darkness, and now we walk in the marvelous light, and let our light so shine that the world might see our Father, and let him be glorified. When God brings us out of darkness and turns on the light, then we see Jesus. Old things are passed away, and all things become new. We become a new creature. We're no longer creepy. We become new creatures. We see Jesus. His saving ministry, his saving work, his salvific work. But in order for that to happen, he had to taste death for every man, meaning every person, men, women, boys, and girls. One thing that arrested me this morning was this verse right here. Somebody wrote a song that said, what kind of love would voluntarily put itself in harm's way? Deacon Robert Williams would tell you that Isaiah 53, verse 5, said he was wounded for our transgression, bruised for our iniquities. But I peeked over at the New International Version, and it said he was wounded for our transgression, crushed for our iniquities. I said, wait a minute. Wounded is one thing, but crushed has a whole other connotation. Are you praying with me? God, love prevailed in the saving ministry of Jesus. I know you know that. Jeremiah 31:3 said, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Sometimes in this human life, people promise to love us forever, but forever doesn't last too long if you've been listening to the wrong radio station, you heard that song. I mean, forever lasted 2 years. Forever lasted 18 months. Set with the pointers up in here today, Mr. Pointer and Wim Pointer and Ms. Pat, can y'all stand? Forever for them, it's still going on because it's been over 50 years of marriage right here, y'all. Marriage still works. The blood still works. If somebody could call Spike Lee and Tyler Perry and they could write the Pointer story, it would be a bestseller. Sold out attraction, standing outside the theater, because you're looking at a miracle right there. Miss Pat has been unanimously given the Woman of the Decade Award, Woman of the Century, for loving Mr. William Pointer in the midst of Mr. William Pointer's journey. Help me, somebody. And Mr. Pointer gets a Man of the Decade because allowing God to take him from a life of destruction to a life of being a disciple. You ought to talk to him sometime. If you've got some merit talent that you think you can work to, go talk to them. Got a testimony. Can I get a wave off and to let them know I'm telling the truth from here? If anybody needs to know that there is a God somewhere, 1 John 3:16, if you were in Sunday school, you heard this verse probably last week. Herein we perceive the love of Jesus, that he laid down his life for you and me. Two things are working there. There is a proclamation, but there's also the proof. The proclamation is that he loved you and me. The proof is that he laid down his life. 1 John 4:10 trumpets the same words. Not that we love God first, but that God first loved us and gave his son to be the propitiation, meaning the once and for all, the perfect sacrifice for our sins. They gave the promise of the proclamation, but they gave the proof in that he actually gave. Some folks say they love you, but it's hard to find proof. But when it comes to Jesus and his saving ministry, he not only pontificated, but he proved his love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. If that isn't love, then a sparrow can't fly. If that isn't love, then water ain't wet. If that isn't love, then fire ain't hot. What kind of love? Matter of fact, 1 John chapter 3 says, behold, what manner of love that we should be called children of the Most High God. And the amazing thing about God's love is that God didn't love us because we were so spiritual. He loved us in spite that we were so sinful. God did not love us because we were so faithful. He loved us in spite of the fact that we were so foolish. He had to come down and be born in flesh. The theologians call that the incarnation. For you know, Jesus has always existed in the spirit realm, but for your faith and my life and salvation, he had to become flesh so he could become our kinsman redeemer. Here is what arrested me again. I kept getting arrested this week. He had to become human-like so we humans could become like the Messiah. He was born to die so that you and I could be born again to live. The theologians, y'all, been sending me to school. It's starting to pay off finally. Thank you, church lady, for reminding me that it should have been 4 years ago, but I'm there. I love you, too. It was the kenosis. He emptied himself of his divinity. He emptied himself of his glory. He poured all of this out that he might pour all of him into you and me. He had to take on flesh. The Messiah had to take on flesh so flesh could take on the Messiah. What a mighty God we serve. He was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should take death for every man. The Jewish Christians during this time were paradoxically perplexed. They said, wait a minute. How is it that Jesus is greater than the angels, and angels don't die, yet Jesus is going to die so he can ironically conquer death? Are y'all praying with me? Let me say that again in case you miss it. He had to die in order to conquer death so that you and I would no longer need to fear death. Death is not the grim reaper, as the poet said and stated. Death is merely an usher that ushers us from time to eternity. Death just becomes our valet, that we take off mortality and put on immortality. For when Jesus died, he graced the grave, and Paul shouted out in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, O grave, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? Paul said, matter of fact, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. When we die, we don't go to a dull, dark place, but we get promoted to be with the Lord. Paul said, while I'm down here, I'm a child of God, but when I die, I get to be with the Lord. You and I should be glad and rejoice in the day because of his saving ministry. I don't know about you, but Paul says in Romans chapter 2, verse 4, it's the goodness of God that causes me to repent. Read Deuteronomy 4, 24 when you get a minute. It says the anger of God is like a consuming, destructive fire. And Paul said, I read that, I know about that, but it's not the anger of God that provokes me. He said, when God keeps loving me, and I know I don't deserve it, when God keeps blessing me more than I deserve, when God keeps making a way when I should be crushed to the curb, when God keeps loving me in spite of my bad attitude, when God keeps giving me breath and life every day that I don't deserve, when I think of the goodness of the Lord, that makes me repent and want to live better. Nobody has to beg me to come to worship. Nobody has to beg me to open the Word of God. Nobody has to beg me to pray before I ask God for something else, to thank God for all the many, many things that he's already done. When I think about the love of God, it takes me back to the love that I had for my mama. I wasn't any better than any other boys, but one thing I never wanted my mama to come to see me in jail in a plater in Upper Marlboro, because I knew that she loved me, Deacon Linda, and that would break her heart, and I never want to break my mama's heart. Well, if the love of a mama can make it do right, how much more should the love of God provoke all of us to live better, to open up God's Word, to pray to God without ceasing, to want to come to worship and get in God's presence? Because when we come in God's presence and commune with God's people, something starts to happen. I said before, let me say it again. Church is not always what you get. You might be doing quite well with your blessings pressed down, shaking together and running over. Somebody has gone through a hard time this week, might need a word of encouragement from you. Every now and then, believe it or not, I might need a word of encouragement from you. It's all right to say, Pastor, you're doing a good job, but don't be phony and fake, because I really don't need that. Because every now and then, you might be a blessing to somebody else. Do I have a witness? It ain't always about you. It's not always about me. Matter of fact, sacrificial service is when you go to see somebody and you don't need anything, but they need a word. They need a prayer. Stop driving by all the hospitals and say, Lord, bless them. No, park your nice car in the garage and go see somebody. Because if it were you there on your back, you would want somebody to come by and say a prayer for you. When I think of the goodness of the Lord and the fact that you and I are saved this morning, that's shouting material right there. Psalm 51, verse 5 said, behold, I was shapen in sin and iniquity. Whether your parents were married when you were conceived or not, we were still born with the sinful nature of Adam. So we were born with the S-I-N nature. Then we got a little older and added the S-I-N-S, sinful deeds, to the S-I-N nature, qualifying us for a double condemnation. But by the grace of God, instead of being the recipients and beneficiaries of a double condemnation, we get to live with a triple consolation. For God the Father said, I'll draw him. God the Son said, I'll set him free. God the Holy Spirit said, I'll seal him until the day of redemption. It's the ministry of salvation. I think the Greek word is sozo, healthy in heart, soul, and mind. It, you want to see a miracle? Have you looked in a mirror lately and you save? You looking at one right there. You may not be all that you're going to be, all that God has designed you and I to be yet, but the fact that we are saved and no longer sinners is a miracle right there that's worthy of praising our God and Savior. What a mighty God we serve. He is an awesome God. He is a great God. He's worthy to be praised in the morning, worthy to be praised at the noonday, worthy every now and then, quiet person you are, reserved and all of that, you ought to open your mouth every now and then and just thank God when nobody's listening. You ought to just have yourself a Holy Ghost praise party in your house, in your car, in your room, all by yourself, just based on the goodness of God. I talked to a couple last week, and they convinced me that they both were 80-plus and still in love and still smiling. I said, oh, my God, if you were a storytelling person, you could sneak by for 65. That's another sign of the goodness and grace of God. Do I have a witness up in here today? The little girl and her dad were traveling down 495, so the story was told. And the little girl was highly allergic to bees. Matter of fact, the last time the bee stung her, she barely made it to the emergency room. The doctor said if you had been 5 minutes later, your baby would have died. So there was a bee buzzing in the car as they were about to cross the Woodrow Wilson Bridge as the story went, and she began to panic, reflecting back to her near-death experience. And she was trying to get her father's attention, who was driving and focused on the highway. And she said, Daddy, Daddy, there's a bee! But the father had already been stung. And if you know anything about biology, a bee can only sting one time before he leaves the stinger. That's what Jesus said. You don't have to worry about the sting of death anymore because, baby, I'm your father, and I've already taken the sting out of death, so death can't harm you anymore. I took care of that. So you don't have to be afraid of dying. I'm ready to go. I'm prepared to go, but I ain't in no hurry. Got a few more things I'd like to do. Like to do a few more things for the wife and the family before I go, but should it come, I hope and pray your house is in order. Let me get on to the second point. Child of God, it's time for all of us to elevate our Christian walk. God has been so good to you and to me, to the young and old, single and married, so that all of us starting today at 8:50 should be on our way to being more committed, more dedicated to serving Jesus. That's the least we can do. Pick up your Bible today, and let me slow down and be pastoral for a moment. I'm not just talking about what we do at 8310 Fort Foot Road. There ought to be some prayer in your home with your family and children, husband, spouse, significant others. Amen? And remember in old days there used to be family Bible study? Matter of fact, at some families back in the day, nobody ate a crumb or a piece of gospel bread, nor in the collard greens or candy yams, until somebody had to say a scripture around the table. You better, no, baby, you can't, that's the one you had last week. You better know a new one, or yes, you ain't. But now, Junior's in his room with his own DVD, and Susie down the hall with her iPad. Mom and Dad are on the computer, and everybody eating on different shifts as if we're in the military. No family prayer, no family Bible study, half attendance of worship, and we wonder what's going wrong with our family. I'm preaching to Joseph Lyles as well because my wife reminded me, Reverend Dr. Joseph, Reverend husband, why are you so focused on the church having Bible study? Can you slow your happy stuff down so we can study the Bible? I think I can. Yes, I can. So since she's got on me, I have to get on you all to balance the equation. Start praying at your house. Start reading the Word of God in your house. And then come Sunday when I call out certain scriptures, we know where that is right here, because isn't that amazing how God works? The pastor done messed around and calling out, preaching from the same scripture that we studied this week as a family. Well, bless the name of Jesus. You can help me work it. But if you haven't read all week, you ain't prayed much all week except the time the tractor trailer almost hit you on 295. That's the only time you talk to God all week. You'll focus on getting power and not getting to the hour of power. You more work focused than worship focused, and wonder why life just seems to be going to work, paying bills, going to work. Well, you haven't talked to the master in a while, and I'm not trying to get on your case this morning. I'm trying to help your case. On noonday, we're in Daniel chapter 4. We're looking for diamonds in Daniel. Anybody like diamonds? I thought you would. On Wednesday night, we're a little behind, and we're going to go through the second part of chapter 1 of Diamonds in Daniel. I wasn't going to go here, but I got to be obedient. Let me lower my voice. I was concerned on Wednesday night. I thought maybe I had missed the rapture. You thought you had missed the rapture? What are you saying, Pastor? What are you doing? I looked on the front row and everybody was gone. I looked on the second row that maybe I missed it. Jesus, did you? I know I'm saved. Did I miss the rapture? Did it come? Where's my family? I looked around and saw a few ministers scattered sparsely about, a few deacons sparsely. Maybe the rapture done come and I done missed it, Deacon Williams. So no, the rapture didn't come. They just didn't come. Daniel chapter 1, he says about verse 8, he purposed in his heart not to defile himself. If that is your purpose and that is your goal, to live a holy life before God, then I know some of you got bionic Superman, Wonder Woman schedules. And deep folk got things to do. I understand that, but the problem is if we're too busy for God, we're busier than God ever intended us to be. Pastor, I'm studying my word of God at home. Bless your heart. Can you come bring some of your insight to the house? After the day, I'm going to change that and get back to the text. What a mighty God we serve. His saving ministry. 14 and 15 talks about his subduing ministry. For it became him for whom are all things, verse 10, and by whom are all things, and bringing many sons into glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. The new modern gospel doesn't talk much about suffering, does it? And problems. It talks about prosperity, naming and claiming, money up, money down, money all around. But Jesus said he brought about the ministry of salvation through the ministry of subduing, and it came perfected through sufferings. Reverend Jarvis Williams would tell you in marriage counseling, there are three rings. He proposed romantically, poetically, on one knee with the engagement ring. Then on that day that's really all about the bride, the minister and the groom coming from the side door, but she comes down the center aisle. Come on, help me somebody. Y'all know who the wedding is really all about. I'm just keeping it straight. Happy wife, happy life. Come on, help me out, brothers. She walks on the white runner to signifying that they're not just walking in human, fleshly, romantic love, but they're walking in a holy blood covenant union sanctuary called marriage. And he places the wedding ring on her hand and consummate the vow for richer, for poorer, for better, for worse, in sickness and in health, forsaking herself, except him for all others. So we have the engagement ring and the wedding ring. But I thought you said there were three rings. There are. If you've been married for more than 30 days, you find the other ring. It's called suffering. Maybe 6 months. Maybe a year. But you work through it. Oh, yeah. Marriages are made in heaven. Yes, but they are lived out on earth. Our souls have been redeemed, but it's their flesh that rises up in a marriage, because even if you have a man of God who's trying to serve God, like Joshua 24:15, sometimes in the independent age in which we live, sisters don't like the word. So who? You mean Subway, no submission. It's been mistaught and misapplied. It does not say coercion. It's submission, meaning that, my dear sister, you are wise enough, bright enough, smart enough, financially well able to take care of yourself, but because of God's word, you decide to come under the godly man's covering and protection so he can be a shelter for you in a time of storm. And that man loves God first, and he loves you so much, you know whatever he's asking you to do is for the glory of God and the good of you, so it's all right to submit eventually. The Bible even says, she shall desire her husband. What man don't want to be desired by his wife? Come on, help me, somebody up in here. My little clothes closet, I try to keep things neat, and wife sometimes walk up in my closet. I close the door and hug. She said, stop playing. I said, who playing? I'm serious. Y'all missed it. She starts smiling all up in my closet. Well. Some of y'all ain't been in the closet in a while, I can tell. Y'all don't play no more. It's all serious. It's all business. But the text says she shall desire her husband. And we would like to think because she loves his handsome Christian spiritual Hercules man, that she desires him. But unfortunately, that's not what the text was saying. It's saying that because of sin, she will now desire his God-given position of leadership and try to be the head that's always turning the neck. Let me balance it. Then men that, because of sin, don't want to love her like Christ loved the church. Ephesians 5:25. Husbands, love your wives even as Christ loved the church, even if she didn't cook, even if you didn't get a hug, even if she didn't say good morning, even if she run up the credit card, even. Yeah, that's going to take Jesus, ain't it? That's what I thought. I said on yesterday, many couples plan elaborate weddings, and A list and B list, and Jesus made neither list. He is the divine creator and sustainer of marriage, but yet he did not get invited to be in the wedding. No wonder why we experience short-term disaster relief marriages. Jesus, perfect through sufferings. Some of our greatest lessons didn't come from Howard, Morehouse, Spelman, Harvard, or Yale. They came from the University of Adversity. How can one be made perfect through suffering? It was God's divine plan. He had to suffer on the cross to identify with you and me and our sufferings. But because we serve a mighty God, he's able. Look at what it says here. To make the captain of our salvation. Meaning that he is the pioneer of our salvation. He is the primary initiator. We didn't just wake up and say, you know, I need to get spiritual. No. John 6:44 says, no man cometh unto me except the Father which has sent me draw him. In and of our human fleshly selves, we would never be drawn to Jesus Christ. It's the love of God that touches our heart, spirit, and soul and draws us to Jesus. Are you praying with me? He is the captain of our salvation. He's made perfect through suffering. We see in 9 through 10, his saving ministry. And then we move on, we see his sanctifying ministry. Well, you find that right in verse 11. For both he that sanctifieth and those of us who are sanctified are all one. For which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren. Sanctified means, I heard somebody say, set apart for God's purposes. Because some folk are set apart, but it's not for God's purposes. Before Christ, we were set apart for our own selfish purposes, but now we are being sanctified. I believe the Greek word hagios, or holy. set apart for God's divine services. God didn't just save us to look cute and brag about the fact that we're saved. He saved us and we are being sanctified. Salvation is a one-time act, but sanctification is an ongoing process. None of us have arrived. None of us have halos on our head yet. None of us have become perfect yet. None of us always have the mind of Christ. None of us always love with the love of Jesus. None of us always seek those things which are above. We are being sanctified. We are being set apart for God's services. Are you attracted with me? The key is you and I need to find out what our purposes are. Jesus is the sanctifier, his sanctifying ministry. I believe the name M-Kadesh. He's our sanctifier. He's our righteousness. And then he calls us brethren. It's one thing to be called a sister or a brother, but I like 1 John 3 when he calls us sons and daughters. There's something more intimate about that that appears to me. So we see the saving ministry of Jesus. We see the sanctifying ministry of Jesus. We see him subduing as he subdued the power over death. And no wonder verse 13 says, I will put my trust in him. And again, behold, I and the children which God hath given me. Him knowledge is right when he said, oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. I will trust in the Lord. Matter of fact, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6 says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, lean not to thine own understanding, in all of thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. Let me backtrack just for a minute. The fact that you and I are saved is enough reason right now for us to move out of our complacent place of spiritual growth and begin to move in a brand new direction. Does that make sense to you? We deserve to be in a lake of fire. You, me, and all of us up in here. None of us deserve to be saved. None of us even deserve to be in church this morning. It's just by the amazing grace of God, whether you're young, middle, or old, it's God's grace and mercy that has saved us from what we deserve, giving us brand new life. Colossians 1:21 helps present the case. We were alienated and enemies in our own mind, watch this, because of our wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled. A wreck that has been restored. You and I were wretches undone, one fit to live and one fit to die. Lord, help me somebody. Granddad said you wasn't worth a nickel walking or riding. Only good, not even when you speak, you got crazy dreams. But by the grace of God, we're saved this morning. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he hath redeemed from the hand of the enemy. I was in Satan's hand, but this morning I'm in the hand of God. In Psalm 95 says, we are the sheep of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. I don't know about you, but that's enough right there to get me all wired up, get me all stirred up to think that a sinner like me, a sinner like you, could become a child of God. The problem in the Hebrews was that they had begun to drift away. They had become dull to the word of God. They wanted to be entertained rather than discipled and taught the word of God. Other things seemed much more exciting, consuming their time, than the word of God. But when we think for just a little while, that one glad morning we're going to spend all of eternity in the presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, what Almighty God we serve. Some of you remember how you were. Let me back up for just a moment. Some of you remember how we were. I remember how I was before Christ came in. Some of y'all were a hot tamale. Somebody had a temper. Somebody would push you up under the table. Somebody would rather fight than talk. Somebody was selfish. It was all about them. Me, my, and mine. Somebody was mean for no particular reason. Now you all sweet got the gift of mercy. Not only did you get saved, your children got saved. Not only your children, you got grandchildren that know the You got saved teenagers up in your house who are respectful most of the time and scared the other part of the time not to be. You saw the incident in the school, the substitute teacher pull off his belt. I'm not saying that was good. But I'm not sure it was all bad. Maybe somebody. But you got saved teenagers who know the Lord, who are trying to grow spiritually. Come on, help me, somebody. Some of your children are blessed and doing well, got their own job, got their own house. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory, glory. I'll be glad when I get grown. You be glad. Your parents going to have a hallelujah party by the time you get to 210. Your room has just become the new sitting parlor. Bless the name. All your parents are going to go to Salvation Army. Glory, glory. Let somebody be blessed. Not really. They just saying that. They really love you. They don't really ever want you to leave home till you can go. Come back to visit if you can. As God is shifting us to a more spiritual direction, some of you are going to be amazed. God has some wonderful things to share with you if you would take the time to share with Him. Some parents today are praying for their teenagers. I feel it in my spirit. This young scholarly student has got to college and think he's grown, but he's still on your health insurance. Still asking, checking the mail, did it come yet, for your contribution to his support. Then he won't come home because he's been at the gym lifting. He's flexing. He's about to get a free tattoo in the center of his chest. Boom! Some of y'all still got marks today that you talking about you got it in the war. It was a war, all right. It wasn't the Iraq war either. It was your daddy's Iraq war. He tags you. And that was the final summit. You had a Pax Romana apiece. But the fact that the Bible said in Philippians, he that hath begun a good work in you and me will perform it until he come. Has Jesus come yet? Then fine, he's still working on you and is still working on me. Don't be so quick to be impatient with everybody else's shortcoming as if you and I have arrived. Sometimes we want the gift of mercy to be shared with us, but we have no mercy when it comes to anybody else. But we are being sanctified. God is still working on that tongue. God is still working on that attitude. God is still working on that pride. God is still working on that lackadaisical spirit. God is still working. Thank God he's still working on you and he's still working on me. We are being sanctified. But we ought to be getting better than we were last week, better than we were last year, better than we were last month. There ought to be some signs of progress. There ought to be some measurable signs of growth. We were at a reception yesterday talking with some good Christian friends of the fort, and we had a few moments of reflection of how God has moved us. Certain songs have a way of taking you back down memory lane. Come on, help me, somebody. And you see a little smile break out. We know, oh God, you were something back in the day, but now you're something in a brand new day. You got a brand new talk. You got a brand new walk. You have old things that passed away. You got a brand new way of thinking. You're not the same person. You're being sanctified. Last point, and we're about early today on time for Sunday school. Not only do we see his saving ministry, bless the name of Jesus, God can save anybody. He saves from the guttermost to the uttermost. He saved those that are down and out and those that are up and out. Everybody that has money is not a heathen. But the danger of trusting in your money more than a Messiah is more prevalent with those that are wealthy. Some folk are up and out. Don't be afraid to witness to the millionaire. He still needs Jesus. You can be rich and broke or poor and rich. I'd rather have, because you heard it said many times before, Thornton, Pope, Jenkins, Stewart. I've never seen a U-Haul behind a hearse, and if it was, it wouldn't do the one that's inside no good anyhow. We see his saving ministry. Thank God for his sanctifying ministry. And lastly, this is a good one. His sympathizing ministry. Ephesians 4:15 said, we don't have an high priest that's so distant and far removed. Jesus has experienced every temptation, every problem that you and I go through. He's already gone through and has won the victory. He is a kinsman redeemer. He knows exactly how you feel. Through 16 says, he did not take on the nature of the angels, but he took on the seed of Abraham. Verse 17, wherefore in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren. Watch it, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. Verse 18, as we conclude, for in that he himself has suffered being tempted, is able to succour them that are tempted. Because he has experienced your temptation and my temptation, he can give us comfort and strength to weather our temptation because he was tempted. If Satan will tempt Jesus, surely you and I are not above being tempted. Some of y'all act like y'all ain't been tempted this year, this decade. We like to blame some temptation on the young people. Satan got some temptations for good old seasoned saints. There's some good-looking old men floating around Fort Washington, and good-looking old women, and I mean mature women. Men get old, women just mature. Let me keep that straight. You can ask a man, oh, I'm 75. Woman said, what? Don't be asking me my age, son. Is this 1 Corinthians 10:13 says, there has no temptation that has taken you, but as such is common. But God is faithful and just and will not suffer you to be tempted above that which you're able to bear. Child of God, don't fool yourself. I don't care how long you've been saved, how many times you pray, how many times you fast and pray and call on the name of the Lord. You and I in this flesh can still be tempted. When there's a little something inside of you pulling in a direction that's not spiritual, that might be temptation. Tall and handsome just showed up in your building. You were focused on your work, talking to God, just came out of your quiet time until he came back. Not the men of Fort Hood, but some men have to walk down the hall. Just to see if God's creation was as beautiful as he thought it was the first time. Then your wife sometimes say, isn't that a pretty woman? What are we supposed to say? If you say no, you're lying. If you say yes, you still might be in trouble. She all right. Good answer. But honey, the Bible says, beauty is vain, but a woman that loves the Lord. But God has not given us an excuse to yield to the temptation. That's when we need to be in a relationship with Jesus Christ. Situational ethics never work. You cannot wait until you're in a situation being tempted to decide if you're going to do right or wrong. Too late. We need to be grounded in the Word of God, praying in the Word of God, reading the Word of God, in our worship, focusing on Jesus Christ, having a made-up mind already in advance of any situation that I'm not going to yield myself to sin because I don't want to violate God's law anymore. Yes, I see that. And somebody said this way, one strength of a person is to know their weakness. Don't be in denial if you know something about yourself. Just ask God to help you with that which you know about yourself so that when temptation comes, you'll be able to stand. Pastor, you don't understand. I'm happily married. I'm single and I'm satisfied. I understand. But you're still human. I'm trying to help you today. Some of y'all going to find out what I'm saying before this time tomorrow. Pastor told me. But God, what a mighty God we serve. Granddad put it this way in elementary spirituality. He said, you can't stop birds from flying over your head, but for God's sake, don't let them make a nest. And don't plan to sin in June and then expect God to provide. Not y'all, but some people actually plan to sin. It's in the scheduling, business meeting. Yeah, it's a business meeting. What a mighty God we serve. Child of God, if we are saved, you already know that we, for many, are the only Bibles that they will read. Somebody's watching your life. Somebody's watching my life. Let them see Jesus. Are you praying with me? If you got habits and patterns in your life right now today at 9:15 that you know are not pleasing to God, repent, cry out to God, ask God for forgiveness, ask God to give you strength to go in a new direction, ask God to keep you from being the sinful person that you no longer want to be. Anybody got any areas of life that need to be changed? Or am I the only one here that needs a few changes in my life? The rest of y'all have already arrived. You've already attained. It's time for the church of the living God to be the church to realize that we have been bought with the precious blood of Jesus. His blood has blotted out all of my transgressions. So, therefore, we are new creatures. We are new people in Christ. And, therefore, it's time to make a change in my life. I can love somebody. I can help somebody. I can do more for the name of Jesus Christ. Pray for me. I got one project this week. I got two cousins homeless. Got to try to help them get out of that situation. If you know somebody that has a room, these should be the hearts and concerns of God's people. If life is good for me, who can I help? Who can I be a blessing to? God said, well, you got an extra bedroom when the little nephews go home. You want to come stay with me? My house, your house, or is it God's house? Hello? I'm just saying we got to do more than come inside these walls. The real ministry begins after the benediction. Matter of fact, start with your own family. There's enough work normally right there in your own neighborhood. Do you know your neighbors on your own street? Do they know you're a child of God? Do they know you've been born again? Do they know you've been saved? Do they know you got the Holy Ghost? Do they even know who you are? Do you even speak when you... I don't bother with people. Who are you going to bother with? Somebody bother with you and me? I'm just praying as I conclude that we would become the church of the living God. Ministry is about to be birthed in the month of June. Some young person needs your ear because they remind you of you when you were 16 and couldn't nobody tell you nothing about nothing. You thought you had mastered life at 17. Surely by 18, 21, you knew everything needed to be but somebody pulled you aside and loved you. That's the church. Titus, two women, the older women taught the younger women. Titus, two men, the older men took time to nurture the young men. You know, didn't know nothing about being a husband and a father. You got father and grandkids. You ought to pull them aside. Take them to lunch.